Du weißt.
Right. So, welcome everyone to the first session of the Flowably podcast here with Pete Fraser and Dr. Diana Christova. We are wellness and flow enthusiasts who just inevitably came together through the Founder University program, but we could not stop talking about flow, and one thing led to another, so we were like, we should start a podcast, we should start a vlog. Welcome, Pete.
Yes, thank you, Dr. D. I think the true story there is I saw what Dr. Diana was doing and chased her down on every type of social media that I could.
That's sort of
between
true.
the platform messaging and the LinkedIn. I mean, it was aggressive, and I was like, we need to talk about this stuff more. So here we are. It's finally happened. It's a pleasure to be here.
Lovely to have you. Lovely to explode about topics that are just so important nowadays. Why we talk about flow, why we talk about wellness. Well, Great Resignation's one reason, you know, everyone going crazy over, is it meaningful what they're doing? Why the heck aren't they taking care of themselves, of each other? And in this intersection, we find a lot of many questions that remain yet to be answered for each person, like what do I care about? How much of my time do I want to spend taking care of myself? In what way? How do I reach flow, and what's meaningful for me? Because maybe like not every feedback providing control oriented focused behavior is to be called flow. So yeah, we are just scratching the surface, I feel, before diving in, because in the pre-conversations with Pete, we've got like some very profound and interesting aspects of what wellness means at all, what flow is at all to us. Our background, maybe like in brief, I have a PhD in cognitive science, 24 or 5 years dancer and practitioner of all sorts of movements, and now since a few years I'm in wellness coaching. So a totally different background, so mostly academia and some a lot of arts, than Pete, who maybe would like to say a few words about.
Yeah, sure. I always like going after a bunch of people who have a bunch of credentials, because I have zero. So this is great. I was an engineer by training, and I'm currently finishing up my master's in business administration at Cornell University. I spend all of my free time doing as much creative work as I can. I think that's what led me to this accelerator, what formed the connection between the two of us. And it's just sort of this third party guiding my life, and I try to listen to it as often as I can, through whichever creative avenues that comes up. So a couple passions include writing, snowboarding, working out, traveling. I'm hoping to make, we were just talking before the show started about Varna, Bulgaria. I'm excited to put that on the travel list. Nice. But yeah, just intriguing conversations like this are what life's all about.
Yeah, and I think that Pete's been like way too modest here. I think that you're like your writing passion doesn't actually, like, you know, many people have writing passion, but like not many people have already authored a book, which maybe like so as you have. So I would love to touch upon this just briefly, and about your entrepreneurial journeys with several startups, and about your future investment banking kind of orientation, which starts in a few months, as far as I know. More seriously, more focused. So
I'm
gonna be the kind of like the person who speaks the truth here, because I think you're way too modest.
All right, so running down the list very quickly, I started my first business when I was 23, just out of college, in the capital market space. It was called Black Swan. It was a tremendous failure, and now I'm on to my second and third startups, which are Buoy, which is focused on getting rid of predatory lending in the world, as well as B School
Yes,
Prep.
Please do this.
Yes, it's an important problem to fix. And then we're also kind of educating the next generation of business school students. In addition to that, I wrote a book called Wall Street Dropout, which I'm excited to publish as soon as I get into investment banking. It's going to cause a huge fireworks show. But it's all about a guided reflection on your purpose and maintaining a great kind of mental peace by releasing fear, judgment, and control. So I think all of these topics, you know, have a unique way of coming together, especially in the flow and wellness state. And that's why we're here today to talk to you, Dr. Diana, about your experience, flow, and wellness. So are you ready to get into it here?
Yeah, I totally am. And I want to say that this is the instant fit that I saw because of, okay, obviously your background's very interesting, but it's also you're the person who I know to practice wellness, practice flow, not just read books about it. So for me, this is the reason why we're here on this podcast and ready to go deeper into it, like a small, maybe like small roadmap of what's going on. Like today, I have the privilege of being interviewed by Pete. So maybe like we're gonna get a sneak preview into what am I all about? Why is wellness and flow so crucial in my life? And so basically to understand the background of my entrepreneurial journey with Flowably, which is a wellness coaching. At the point service, but soon hopefully also an app and a digital tool to support people, improve their wellness and flow. And also already got a exciting co-founder, Phoevos Giannopoulos. So we're merging forces there as well to bring wellness and flow to the world. It sounds like Messiah work, like maybe it is in the digital age. But yeah, kudos, like so we're the messiahs of wellness and flow, and today I get interviewed, then next episode we're going to talk a bit about it, about Pete's motivation, and then we run into a weave of incredible guests from most continents we could think of, from most backgrounds, entrepreneurs, academics, and we're going to be talking about these topics, also sports people, arts people. Let's just kick this amazing journey off right now.
You know, you bring up we're going to interview someone from each continent, and I think it'd be great to get a penguin on the show, because the like when they are sliding across the ice, they're just 100%, you know, it could be an interesting interview. Okay.
I mean, you might be joking, but in animal world, if you're not in flow, you're usually dead. So like flow is a
important
sort of
lesson to learn.
States that you're aiming. Yes, that is, I absolutely confirm.
Okay. Well, I want to start out with the burning question of not a lot of PhDs go quickly into the entrepreneurial route. Maybe like after they publish a million papers and have this very successful academic career, you jumped right into becoming the CEO of Flowably. What was that decision?
That was a decision that was always kind of around the corner, because I find meaning in knowledge being applied. And even my PhD project, it was together with two further amazing colleagues. And we had an applied part in which we were doing workshops with adolescents on digital literacy. And this was, I also selected the method for my PhD to be interviews, because I just saw how much immediate revenue, like a takeaway messages and deep reflection is facilitated through these practices. So for me, even doing science was about creating the knowledge. In German, they say Wissenschaft. So like science, the word for science is to create knowledge. But it was about taking this knowledge to the people it came from. And in an interview, it happens immediately because people self-reflect and like things happen that are totally unexpected in terms of recognitions. But I feel like a lot of science has become has become endemic, kind of like they study, they suck in some knowledge and publish it, but it's just me and a few geeks read that and that's about it, with a lot of incredible input. Like I've done research for years on improvisation, on skills. I've done skills research, done research on task difficulty, so the difficulty of problems, which is one of which is conductive of flow, because you know you can't have like if a task is too difficult or too easy for the person, they can't be in flow, they'll be bored or frustrated. So a lot of mind-blowing recognitions all over the years. It's been like 12 years in academia. And I want that knowledge to make impact into the world. So I'm kind of like very open and sharing about it. And entrepreneurship is probably like is so far the best way that I found, because I'm blessed to not be amputated by organizational structure. I'm a free thinker, free researcher, with a lot of knowledge to share, with a lot of skills, and I can create, or this is at least the wish to create a structure in which we can facilitate this knowledge sharing, get it out. Like this is why I'm also super excited to have Fivas on board, and like some further amazing people join us down the road also. Like I know you got like plenty of startups, but like I'm also like just saying hi to Pete, but let's see. Because collaboration with cognitive scientists, and also data scientists, people with IT background like Fivas, and the further people we're considering for the startup, is gonna allow us to scale, to amplify this knowledge to reach more people, which for me, this is just, it's just fair. I've spent so much time acquiring the knowledge, keeping it to myself just doesn't seem to make any sense at all.
Yeah, no messiah would keep the information they have to themselves. they got to spread that out.
Spread love.
You talked about task difficulty, and I want to double click there and say, where is the connection between task difficulty and this idea of flow? What is that about?
Well, the classical depiction of the flow channel is somewhere in between, you know, when your skill matches the difficulty of the task. Also, I mean, obviously you have to have this massive intention and motivation to do the task. So, you know, not every task can induce flow for you. But if the task is too difficult as compared to your skill set, and you're nervous, then you're not gonna enjoy it. You're just gonna feel like every step is burdensome. Mm-hmm. So getting into flow from this state is like is very difficult, because flow state is optimal performance, optimal experience. It pushes your performance, so you don't stagnate. But you cannot be so frustrated that you can't move and you feel like you've got like nothing to share there and to improve and be in flow. Conversely, if the task is just boring and you're bored out of your mind, your mind automatically starts searching for any sort of distraction that's gonna take you away from the existential loss of reality. I think like Heidegger was writing about boredom. He actually conducted some experiments with his students, like boring them to death while talking about boredom. And I mean to death, like these people, he wanted them to experience the existential loss of touch with reality. And I feel like this is also, this is well established that this is not conductive of flow. So the task difficulty is connected to skills research and expertise, is the niche, the sort of understanding of facilitating flow that can happen on structural level. Of course, there's some, like in here, here come the improvisation skills, how to be unstuck, to get yourself unstuck, mm-hmm. how to bootstrap yourself, how to not go into like places where you don't have any more options, but to facilitate your options. Like all these are skills that come later, but I just, you know, also to answer your previous question with why entrepreneurship, I just realized, you know, all the things that I researched provide me with a very, very rare, and I mean, because I know it, like I know how many colleagues work on these topics, and also the just the combination of them is so rare. So I realized that this is something that I could contribute with to people because of my academic background and because I'm in flow between 4 and 6 hours each day. Mm. So average of 4 hours for work, minimum, I'd say, actually, and 2 hours during training. So I think that this is the sort of skill set and background that I could use both in analytical and experiential term to communicate this elusive state that everyone so craves.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So you said there that you're in flow for 4 to 6 hours every single day, or at least maybe during a working day. Are you just rolling out of bed and just like putting on your flow hat and getting to it? Like, how are you structuring your day in a way to be in a flow state so much?
The thing is, like, the particular key for myself as the constellation of a person I am is to have a good balance between structure and freedom. So a lot of, you know, this is a self-determination theory with, you know, like autonomy having as a first value, let's say it like that. So basically I want to have structure for my day, and I, you know, follow a routine as much as I can. I enjoy getting out of bed, if possible going to the seashore, if not I'm going to work there later and then go into a training in the evening. So like a lot of my days look like that. So there is some structure to it, which takes away a lot of the cognitive effort. I don't have to make like huge decisions about the framing of my day, but within that I'm flexible. So I choose a task that I need to work on, for example, but it's kind of like I pay attention to leave like proper time for it, so to say, that I don't, you know, that I can be mindful for as long as, you know, the ecstasy of flow rides drives me to, because if I have calls in between, you know, like I for example, I try to cluster my calls in such a way that I don't, you know, that I can do a call, maybe a bit of a break, then another call. And this is the call flow, but to have vast spaces of time of uninterrupted attention where I invite for flow, of course, it doesn't always work, but I become insanely good at facilitating it for myself, like knowing the music that I listen to, to have my phone on silent and things like that, and just, you know, to invite it, and mostly it comes. And sometimes it's just, you know, I can't stop working, and it's the type of work that actually brings top performance as well. It's not trying hard to look busy for the boss, because I don't have a boss, so I guess it's just trying hard to impress the boss with how much fun I'm having today and how much, you know, creativity can come out of, you know, a single day.
It's going to be the benefit of being the CEO, right? You are the boss. You just talk to yourself. You're like, what are we going to do today?
Well, in a sense, yes. I think that this has a lot to do with it. I mean, I think you know, having a boss, having a structure in your company can facilitate your flow as well, if they're sensitive to your needs, because it can take away a lot of the worry, like entrepreneurship for people who just come out of academia or people who are generally not used to the entrepreneurial journey, brings a lot of anxiety, a lot of self-criticism, perfectionism, you know, so it's first it's a skill to get around this, and then like it comes with a price, you know, the sort of relative freedom comes with a price. So I think that people who are employed by people are also really maybe even more protected, depending on the work environment, of course, but there are opportunities for flow if your collective, your manager, your structure recognizes that you need this mindful time to like not be constantly bothered, because for many people, unfortunately, this is the aspect that does not at all allow them to focus, you know, because multitasking, we all know, is a fraud. It's like the thing that is literally robbing us of our abilities, of our inner sense of peace and focus that we can tap into to connect flow.
Yeah.
As you well know, because you know, with your experience, I suppose, like you've encountered the perks and the downsides of being a CEO, like Bui, for example, now, or your previous entrepreneurial journey. So there is a downside, but it's always about using the advantages to the best that you can.
Yeah. I'll hearken back to something you said of one of the signs that you're clearly out of flow seems to be if you're stuck or bored. And I think while you feel stuck almost every day as an entrepreneur, you're like, I need to be 14 totally. Steps ahead of totally. Where I am. You're never feeling bored. And then there's that intellectual stimulation is sort of one of those catalysts to flow. So maybe we can go back there and say, if stuck and bored is like, I'm definitely not in the flow zone. What are some characteristics of being in the flow zone?
Yeah. Oh man, like the topic with the entrepreneurial thing is like, because I didn't want to sugarcoat my story, there is a lot of that, but I make a point of it because I am a flow and wellness coach and I practice what I preach. I don't intend on my entrepreneurial journey like to lose the very core values of myself that I would like to share with the world from my heart, from my experience. So the stuck part can actually facilitate your flow. I mean, like, at least this is how I see it, because it just feels so frustrating. It's so disturbing. It's like maddening, right? But the same way that in songs you've got like a suspension, you know, like building up the tension, and like the beat drops, or there is a release, and this is well used in music to create, you know, to manage emotions. You know, you don't just go level and like everything's fine, right? Like that's not flow.
Sure.
But like you can use this suspension to then be like, okay, fuck this. I'm not gonna invest time into that because I'm so stuck, and I'm taking this task and I'm just riding with it. And you know, like with given the right for in my case at least, like some people don't like listening to music while working, but like if I put on the music that gets me already into this kind of trance-like state, and I have one task selected, and I know I don't have any calls, I don't need to check my phone all the time, I'm just I'm launching the flow rocket, you know. It really literally feels like that. Yeah. So you can cultivate the awareness of, you know, what does feeling stuck even mean, right? Maybe you just selected the wrong thing to focus on right now, you know. Maybe you give yourself the I'm trying to do a routine task here, which is insanely boring and to the extent that it's maddening. Whereas right now I feel creative, and you know, if you ride then with a creative wave, you can go like very far, and I mean like very far. So you need to be attentive to yourself. And like right now, for some of our listeners who are employees, maybe that sounds like hippie talk and like, you know, spoiled with the flexibility that we have, but it is possible. It's not possible every time. I mean, also for an entrepreneur, there are so many things to do and so many, it has to be done. So there is a lot of pressure, even maybe more. But if you look to optimize doing what you feel like, so sometimes you're just mindless and you want to do a routine task and this is it. And if you are able to attend to yourself, to flexibly structure your list in such a way that you can attend to whatever you're most strong at right now, I think that you can improve your flow time several times. I think I'm not exaggerating here. We're not talking about small changes. Usually, like when you ride on flow, it can really be something, like it can be a big change.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's conjuring up images of like meditation and yoga a little bit when you talk about follow your breath, build an awareness, follow your creativity. It's kind of like you're being pulled in a direction and the first step seems to be like building an awareness. Is that the right way to think about it?
I certainly see the connections there, because it's all about consciousness fine-tuning. And if you're not attentive to yourself, I mean, like, people are trampling their wishes, feelings, motivations, and then wondering why they don't feel flow. I mean, obviously, you can't feel flow if you just, you know, brutalize yourself every day. I mean, there is a certain quality of attention and presence with yourself, which needs to listen to what needs to emerge. You know, like you, my professor, Marcus Peschel, was in cognitive science. He was talking about this, like, because he's also big into design and designing enabling spaces, etc. And he was always talking about this, listen to the future that wants to emerge. So when guiding a creative process, yes, there is a lot of listening. You can't, I mean, of course, there is a lot of expression as well, I guess, but you need to fine tune to what is needed, because none of us is like detached to the extent that it doesn't matter who our audience is going to be. Like right now we're talking, but like we're choosing a language that people will understand. We are not going and doing some weird things just for the extravaganza. It's always like about who can you connect with, how can you connect with, and you start with yourself. So for sure, awareness is a big must for it.
Okay. You know, I think this is a perfect opportunity to pivot to kind of our second section of wellness, because like you said, flow is energizing and excellent. And it can pull you into this like exponential performance curve, but it's pretty much meaningless if you're just trampling your own emotions and your well-being. So let's talk about how do you structure your emotional state, or maybe you want to start with the physical side, whatever, however you prioritize your kind of emotional or physical well-being. I'd love to hear about one of those.
This is a very important it's a very important topic, because if it comes to emotional side, you just are who you are in the moment that you're in, and the important part is to be authentic about it. No use of, you know, everyone has some down days, even the people who are tough cookies and don't want to be seen as vulnerable or weak or whatnot. Everyone has some days which are better than others. And, you know, if on a day where you're low creativity, low mood, and you try to, you know, be super creative and happy, it's just not going to work. I mean, like, maybe you can make an Aikido arm twisting to yourself, and you can land in a position, you can self-facilitate in a way that you improve your energy and so. But like, it's ideal if you just know, okay, got the tasks, what fits me most right now, how flexible I am with them, or not. Even for people who are, I don't know, even if you're working at the counter and you have people coming all the time, you can choose, you know, you can be polite, but be at your energy level. You don't have to be like feeling horribly, like really poorly today and welcoming with, hi, I'm so glad to see you. No, like you can say, hi, I'm so glad to see you. And you just stay, you do your job, you do your work, but you stay a bit more authentic and close to your natural self. So I'd say first is the authenticity aspect of it, to not try and stretch the yo-yo too far. It's going to return like in the opposite direction. It's going to hit you real hard.
Mm-hmm.
And about the physical, it's just, again, like you've got some energy level of the day. Sometimes you're super hyped up, anxious, maybe nervous. Sometimes you're more sluggish. You don't want to come out of bed, and you just find the few movements that feel tasty for you right now. That makes sense, because, you know, if you're super sluggish and you want to jump around, and like, it's not going to happen. This is violence. It's like mismatch. So I think that this is the leading the red line for alignments. And for me, actually, wellness and flow, they're in no way separate things. Like if I like my wellness in my work, apart from, you know, moving and like having break and nice moments for my body, for me actually flow is the wellness of my work, of my mind, of my creativity, of like my potential. So they're, I don't see them as separate. It's really.
That's I feel like we could go down a tunnel here of kind of oneness and how there's this core of flow and then expanding out to physical and emotional wellness. And I want to keep one thing that you said before we go down that rabbit hole, maybe, is why is it so hard for us to show up authentically, be it at work or sometimes even with our partners? You know, you talked about doing that kind of emotional harm. Like, how do we stop doing that? Why do we do that?
Because nobody, like, historically speaking, most of the people didn't want us to be authentic because society would fall apart, presumably. I mean, this is why we've got all the social norms and politeness, or like be more formal. I think it's just many of the masks that we put on socially are just for convenience, for reducing complexity, because, you know, nobody wants you to be in a bad mood when you're providing service for them. But in the end, what I find is a beautiful development among all sorts of practitioners, all sorts of professionals, entrepreneurs, big time, it's just authenticity. You know, like if you're very good at what you're doing, you know, like walking barefoot in your office, why not? Like, I love that. And I love this approach, because, this is the sort of stories I come across all the time, because like my friends were IT people working for a very successful mobile game development company, and they're, you know, it's a regular story. The one of the co-founders, who is worth millions in like net worth, just walking around in a metal t-shirt and barefoot, you know, like, because the guy is so good at his job, he doesn't, like, in creativity and what he's creating, he doesn't need to pretend. And I don't, you know, here I'm not trying to push people down the path of the eccentric millionaire, because, like, this is not a role that's meant for many people. And I also think it can be equally fake, right? You know, maybe, like, this is just a ability to, like, to what extent are you allowed to express yourself? And always, you know, in creativity, you have you have constraints. You having creativity with no constraints is actually extremely difficult. Mm-hmm. And this is also what research shows. What, you know, when you talk to dancers and you tell them be creative, and they're like, doing what do you want from me, you know, what, like, what's the emotion, what's the background, what's the music, what's the length of, like, what do you want to explore? Like, I can be creative, but, you know, give me constraints. So I think not think, but, like, you know, from a point of view of improvisation researcher, I can say that these constraints are always going to facilitate our creativity. It's just important that we keep playing with them, keep pushing them as far as possible, because sometimes they're very rigid. They're facilitated by very rigid people. Mm-hmm. This is also fine because intellectual styles are different. And for some people, it's just very important that things are measurable, predictable, controllable. So I understand why this comes about, but there is freedom in the finer nuances, you know, like you can be forced to be, you know, if you're a flight attendant, you're forced to be nice and communicative and helpful. But even within that emotional labor, you have the choice of, am I going to be the super prickly, super inspired, very happy professional today? Am I gonna be the calming, gentle presence of groundedness? Am I gonna be the one who jokes? You know, like there is within the nuances of behavior, within the constraints. So you have constraints, nuance of behavior. You have like a freedom of nuance that, like, I am very happy to state that nobody can take away, because it's just there, and it's a matter of seizing it and coming, even if you come just one tiny step closer to your authentic self within the constraints that you have, this is already a huge win, and it's going to make all the difference for your wellness, for the way you carry out your work, for the way you associate with your profession. Because if you're so fake at work, I mean, it is maybe a desired like fake manifestation. So not, mm-hmm. not every fake is a glitch, so to say, but it's a question of how long can you hold this up? You know, is it worth it, even if you have different needs, to hold on to, for dear God, to some ideal looks and self for 20 more years? It's a personal question. Maybe it's worth mm-hmm. it, because it serves a purpose of, you know, you always wanted to be like that, and it's what you want to display. But it is a personal choice, and I'm very glad to report that a lot of people, also, you know, as witnessed by the Great Resignation, are rethinking what's their worth of their labor. Why are they doing this? Are they in the right place? Is this fulfilling? Is it meaningful? Are they themselves? Are they connected to their deeper needs? Or are they just trying to play the game by the book that in the end a lot of people care about, but there are many ways to play the book without violating yourself too much?
Yeah, it seems like with the Great Resignation, folks are understanding their constraints, but then building this awareness that we talked about in flow of, what are my own needs that I may have been putting off for 10 years or 20 years? Or it's very interesting to see that on a global level. And it brings to mind this idea of alignment, of even if your career is going very well, like I see this in the Wall Street investment banking world, your career can be going amazing and your plan can all be working out, but there can be forgotten pockets of yourself that are undeveloped and sort of like crippling up, yeah. and like a plant that needs to be watered. And you said you've done a lot of interviews in your work. Is that more what you've seen. Like people are, oh yeah, everything's fine. Like family's good, job's good. But then there's also these dying plant side of them. I don't.
I've been fortunate to have amazing customers. So like first things first, because I've talked like in different contexts, I've talked with a lot of professionals who are exactly like how you describe it. Some stuck in macho IT cultures where you have to be like the programmer, like with bro in front.
So, I cannot like, imagine macho and IT going together.
Oh, dude, you have no idea.
That's very funny. No, like but... a bunch of like pocket protector guys.
Like, well, IT is not what used to be in the like 20 years ago. It's like geeks come in all shapes and sizes these days. And, you know, there are a lot of, you know, people who are just stuck in a culture that is very, I mean, male in the sort of not very, currently not very nice sense. I mean, in a sense that you have to at all costs be not sensitive. Maybe you can be sarcastic, ironic, pushing each other, which is, it can be very cool, very cute, right? But, you know, in the long run, if you don't feel like you're allowed any expression of any vulnerability in your team, then of course you're pushed to you're pushed to hide certain things and certain needs, and you know, to keep it simple, to keep away from emotion. So then this is where, for example, you can see suppression or people who want to you know, present a certain image so strongly that they themselves have forgotten that they have certain needs. So it's not sometimes the fake is so deep that the real is forgotten. This is something that society very often has as an effect on its members, because it's like now I feel like we're all a bit too hip, not too, but like, I mean, for my taste is great, but like for some people, the new new Western generations, or let's say technologically advanced societies, so not just Western, you have people who are craving more self-expression and more authenticity, and they're more generally more in touch with their emotions and like recognizing what's fake, you know, in a sense, because we're all faced with the perfection of Instagram, with the perfection of this, of that, the highlight reel of others' lives. So we're trying to perform very hard as well. You know, you can try to perform really hard to be a successful yoga teacher. Like, I'm the most peaceful person, and I'm the most modest person in the room. And like, what's not? And like, Bali and this and that. Like, been there, done that, right? But I think that there is generally a bit more seeking for what's authentic, seeking for your expression, etc., which maybe like in previous generations or in cultures where they're more focused on functioning and not so much on your hippie bippy emotions, I see that nowadays we have like an opening for a lot of possibilities to reassess pretty much everything. And whether we resign from our job or not, like it's another thing. Whether we find new avenues as a volunteer outside of the job, but there is a huge need for meaning. And this is also why, you know, with Flowably, I don't just my idea is not just to analyze the heck out of some situation and some people, like put in categories, and like there is categories will help a lot for sure. And I'm thrilled working with that, you know, to facilitate flow for people. But my idea and wish, and also, you know, aligned with my co-creators at the startup, is to have a humanizing effect on people, you know, to be like, right, we're developing technology, but we also need to develop the human tech, because this is just important. It's the process of the evolution of consciousness. We have not destroyed ourselves yet. So mm-hmm. I personally want to support consciousness to become the most, like the consciousness of people to become the more beautiful, the more generous, honest, connected to self and others that it can be. And maybe then we don't even destroy ourselves, you know, who knows, maybe it's possible. But evolution is also evolution of consciousness is a game of like, what level do I reach before we self-destruct? So I just hope to contribute to that flow.
Well, let's try to wrap all this up in one final question. So we've got a new generation of people, be they old and young, not by age, but just by evolution, who are asking more questions about how can I become more aware? How can I listen to myself, rediscover my inner self and align to that direction in life? And you've got Flo Obley, who's cheering on from the sidelines saying, yes, do this. Here's some benefits to it. How do you see, what's the Flo Obley mission for that generation? Like, how do you guys serve those people who are looking to accomplish that inner journey?
Well, my initial, the short answer is to make some incredibly complicated, intricate science easy and usable for the people. So basically, all this with which we have worked through with my colleagues, like I talked about my background with Phoebus, he's also has background in psychology, neuroscience, linguistics. So basically all venues of cognitive science. And for us, it's just incredibly important to bring that research to use in a very simple way. So so now I'm doing coaching. We're expanding our understanding of what people need, what sort of problems they have. We want to be data driven. Because, you know, obviously a lot of theory out there, but it's about the people and about the current journeys they're on. But the idea is to just end up with an app which looks so simple, and it provides you with guidance in this vast ocean of wellness and flow information. It's overwhelming, it's too much, it's just so much information, and you can become specialist. And the offensive part almost is that you can become specialist in these topics, but knowledge does not imply behavioral change. Mm-hmm. We see that with like ask just about any researcher of anything, and you see that only a fraction actually put to work what they know to be good for them. And here is our work to find the language for each person, for each, you know, type of people, to find the language to communicate to them in a way that they will understand, in a way that is so simple for them, that they will actually find the door into this. And the mission of Flow Obley here is to facilitate the beginning, you know, to of course, like, because it's so easy. I am a trained, my background is in sports, in performance arts. I have a background as a trainer. And it seems so easy, you know, once a person is starting to roll already, to tell them, okay, you should then increase the difficulty according to their progress, etc. But nobody really talks about the inception, about the start. And this is where I see people, most of our clients struggling, like, where is the seed, the start of the change that is just not the knowledge, but it's already the gentlest of steps towards implementation. So this is where we would like to support people and make some very complicated science just very easy and useful for the community, the global community.
Well, Diana, I think that's a beautiful place to end. Thank you for your time today. This was great.
Thank you for the insightful questions and connection. And as already mentioned, next time I'm going to have the privilege of interviewing you and gaining some insight into your wellness and flow journey. I say this as a disclosure to our listeners that it is our purpose here to gather a beautiful encyclopedia of experiences, of honest sharing of flow, wellness, and also the difficulties associated with it, because it's not all flowers and roses, but it's about us as a collective connecting together and making more of our experience, making it count as knowledge pool that's shared, accessible to us, to each other, and to just make a difference in our lives. So I'm very much looking forward to that, to next week, Pete. Thank you. All right.